The Melba Story. The story of Australia's most famous woman. The true story, fully authenticated, and featuring another wonderful Australian singer, Glenda Raymond. The Melba Story. In 1893, Melba set off on her first trip to America, having been offered a fabulous amount for a season at the New York Metropolitan. She'd always hated sea travel, and would have been much happier had she been born a generation later, and so been able to cross the turbulent Atlantic by air in a matter of hours. In her day, however, she was forced to travel in an 8,000-ton ship with a single-screw engine. And when, in mid-ocean, a fierce tempest arose, Melba told her secretary, Louis Bennett, that their last moment had come.
It's the end, Louis. It's the end of us all. Don't talk like that, Nellie. We'll be all right.
But the lights have gone out. They'll come on again.
You're so calm, Louis.
You're wonderful.
I'm not half as calm as I sound.
Then you're frightened too.
Of course I am.
Louis, couldn't we all sing something?
Sing something?
Yes, a hymn. What was the hymn that was written during a storm at sea?
Lead Kindly Light, wasn't it?
That's right. That's the one. Let's all sing it together.
Oh, Louis.
You start, Nellie, please.
I'm imagining things or not, but it seems calmer to me.
The ship isn't rolling so much.
I think the storm's over.
Look! The lights are coming on!
That's better. That's much better. The kindly light mid the encircling gloom.
We're safe now.
Yes. But just the same, I'll be glad when we reach New York.
Welcome to New York, madam. How do you like our first city?
It's very different from London, Mr. Growl.
Yeah, well, naturally, the pace is much faster, as it were. We move along here, you know.
Yes, I noticed that on my way from the hotel. The cab kept jolting over the cobblestones until I felt that every bone in my body was almost shaken out of place.
Well, don't you get that sort of thing in London?
Oh, no. The streets over there are smooth, and our hansom cabs are much more comfortable. But I'm prepared to admit that this new Metropolitan Opera House of yours is much more impressive than dear old Covent Garden. I'm looking forward to my first appearance. When is it to be, Mr. Growl?
I'm afraid I have some bad news for you, madam.
Oh, what's happened?
Anne Dufresne, who was to have played opposite you in Lucia, has been taken suddenly ill. We'll have to find a new Edgardo.
Is there only one tenor in New York?
No. Vinyas is studying the music now, and she'll be all right.
Should be all right. That's comforting for me, I must say.
Well, to tell you the truth, I think it was a mistake to choose Lucia for your opening performance.
Why?
Well, for one thing, it's a Patti opera.
I didn't know that any prima donna had a copyright on one particular opera.
Oh, what I meant was that Patty has always been identified with the role. And as she's making a farewell tour of the United States at the present time, well, the choice may have been injudicious.
I'm prepared to be judged on my merits.
Well, that's just the point. You may not be.
You mean they'll be prejudiced against me?
It's inevitable, I'm afraid. And besides, you mustn't forget that because of the fire, there hasn't been any grand opera in New York for 2 years. You'll be singing to a new house, to an audience that won't be particularly opera-minded.
A new country, a new opera house, a new tenor.
I think, Mr. Growl, that you'd better get a new soprano as well. I'm beginning to be sorry that I ever came to America.
Now, please don't judge us too harshly, madam. At least wait until your first appearance before an American audience.
And when will that be?
I'd like you to sing at a charity concert next Thursday afternoon.
The famous Australian soprano, Madame Melba, will sing Lol, Hear the Gentle Lark.
plays certainly like that, Nellie.
They seem to, but that's not opera.
Nellie, there's a Mrs. Perrin Stevens waiting to see you.
Who's she?
Someone pretty important, apparently. Anyway, the people around here seem to think so. She's 75 if she's a day.
I suppose I'd better go and see what she wants.
Good afternoon.
Hello, Madam Melba. I'm Mrs. Perrin Stevens. But don't believe all you hear about me, my dear.
I assure you, Mrs. Stevens...
That affair with the Italian Count, there was nothing to it, nothing at all. Just malicious gossip. You'll sing for me tomorrow night, won't you?
Well, I don't
know. Name your own fee. I'll pay whatever you ask. You doing anything else tomorrow night?
No, I don't think so.
That's settled, then. Here's my card. You'll find the address there. A dinner at 8. Goodbye.
But Mrs. Stevens...
Don't be late. I can't bear people to be late.
But I haven't said...
All kinds of interesting people. I only have interesting people at my dinners. 8 o'clock. Don't forget. You're very late, my dear. What on earth happened to you? I did say 8 o'clock, didn't I?
Yes, Mrs. Stevens, you did say 8 o'clock. And you also gave me the wrong address.
Oh.
I've been at the other end of town, knocking at the door of the house in which you used to live.
Oh, my goodness
I'd probably be there now, only for a friendly policeman.
Oh, I must have given you one of my old cards. I'm always doing things like that. Never mind, you're just in time to sing for us. Now, what will it be?
Mrs. Stevens, I've only just arrived.
There's a very fine pianist here. Just give him your music. Here, I'll do it.
But Mrs. Stevens...
Now, how about this one? Now, the Song of India. Oh, yes, we must have that. My friends, Madam Melba is about to favor us with a song. The Song of India, in fact.
Well,
are you ready, my dear?
I suppose I'll have to be.
Now, quiet, everyone, for Madam Melba. you, dear Madam Melba. That was delightful. Now that you've sung for your supper, you'd better come and have it. But the evening isn't over yet.
In just a moment, we'll return to the Melba story. The Melba story.
Thank you, dear Madam Melba. And now that you've sung for your supper, you'd better come and have it.
Yes.
But the evening isn't over yet.
Are you sure I've deserved it, Mrs. Stevens?
Oh, yes, you're quite as good as you were cracked up to be. Don't you think so, Mr. Astor?
Well, the best voice I've ever heard.
And he's heard plenty, believe me. You know who he is, of course. John Jacob Astor, simply rolling in money.
Oh, not now, Mrs. Stevens. Things are bad in New York at present. Money's tight, very tight.
Oh, he's always saying that. But don't you believe a word of it, my dear. You know what these millionaires are.
I'm afraid I don't. You see, I haven't met very many millionaires.
But you're rich yourself, aren't you?
Rich, Mr. Astor?
Well, they say you're getting a fortune for this season at the Metropolitan. Of course, they have money to burn.
But you said, didn't you, that things were very bad in New York just now?
Oh, well, I didn't mean...
Don't try to get out of it, my boy. Madam Melba's more than a match for you, I think. You'd better take her into dinner.
And what do you think of this circus, madam?
I beg your pardon?
Since I'm to be your left-hand neighbor during dinner, I'd better introduce myself. I'm Marion Crawford. I write for a living.
Oh, yes, I know. I think I saw a play of yours in London. Something about a cigarette maker.
Yes, it's running there at present. But you haven't answered my question.
What question?
I ask you what you thought of this circus.
Circus?
Well, isn't it? You must admit that Mrs. Perrin Stevens is just a type for an animal trainer. Look at the way she put you through the hoops.
Yes, she certainly did.
Marion, you're entirely monopolizing Madam Melba's attention.
Oh,
I'm sure Mr. Astor's dying to ask her what she thinks of New York.
Well, what is there to think of New York? It's here, and we make the most of it. Isn't that so, madam?
I know very little of New York at present.
John Jacob Astor can tell you anything you want to know about New York. Know why? Because his family owns most of it.
The original John Jacob Astor, my great-grandfather, came to this country in 1783. He made his money by trading with the Indians for furs, and then put every penny he owned into New York real estate. You might say that the Astors were the pioneers of this city.
What about the Vanderbilts?
Oh, they came here later than the Astors.
Yet there was a time when Mrs. Vanderbilt wouldn't call on Mrs. Astor because she thought the Astors weren't her social equals. It's rather different now, eh, John?
Well, I hope the Astors have earned the right to go anywhere.
Yes, even to Westminster. Wasn't it your uncle who attended Queen Victoria's Jubilee and shouted out, "Hurrah for the Queen," in the Abbey?
Why, certainly not.
Then I must have been thinking of somebody else.
Didn't I say she should have been a lion tamer?
I hope she doesn't start on me next.
Well, she won't unless you sing out a tune. But you don't, I'm sure.
No, Mr. Crawford. I hope I never do.
Then, may I come and sing duets with you?
I'd love it. Come tomorrow at 12.
I'll be there.
Signal for Mrs. Stevens. It's time for the ladies to retire. Don't leave us to ourselves too long, will you?
You won't miss us. You'll have Mrs. Stevens.
Did you hear me put John Jacob Astor in his place?
Was that true about Mrs. Vanderbilt's refusing to call on Mrs. Astor?
Oh, yes, my dear. And Mrs. Jerome wouldn't call on either of them. course, she's never been the same since her daughter married Lord Randolph Churchill. She keeps talking about her grandson, Winston. Insists that he has a great future.
Perhaps he has.
Oh, but nobody takes any notice of Mrs. Jerome these days. Now everyone calls on everyone else and takes their character away. Oh, the things they say about me. Now, to take this wig, for instance. You noticed I was wearing a wig, I suppose?
No, Mrs. Stevens, I hadn't noticed.
Oh, I'm not ashamed of it. But people say I wear a wig because I've no hair underneath. Now, that's a lie, an abominable lie. Here, I'll show you.
Oh, please, don't take off your wig.
I want to prove to you all that I have plenty of hair. Ah, there. Look at that.
Here come the men.
Oh, help me get my wig on again. Quickly.
No, not like that. It's back to front.
Hurry.
I can't get it off. It's stuck.
Oh, they're here. Pull it down. Pull.
That's fixed it.
Oh, thank heavens. Ah, come in, gentlemen. We've been waiting for you.
Tell me, madam, are you singing in any other American city?
Yes, Mr. Astor, in Chicago.
Chicago?
Is there something wrong with Chicago?
Everything's wrong with it.
It's vulgar.
It lives on sensation.
It's terribly wicked.
It's called the Babylon of the Plains.
It sounds wonderfully exciting. I'm quite looking forward to singing there.
What opera are you doing in Chicago, madam?
Romeo and Juliet with Jean Dorestre.
No, Nellie. The orchestra has stopped playing and the house is in an uproar.
Oh, look! There's a man climbing over the footlights.
He is mad. He is glaring at us.
He's glaring at me.
Yes, you. You, Madam Melba. I'm going to kill you with my bare hands.
Chicago, the city of sensations, lives up to its name. In the midst of a performance of Romeo and Juliet, Melba's life is threatened. How she dealt with this unusual situation will be told in the next chapter of The Melba Story. The Melba Story was written by John Ormiston Reed and produced by Dorothy Crawford. The Australian Symphony Orchestra was conducted by Hector Crawford. The role of Melba was spoken by Marcia Hart and sung by the Australian coloratura soprano, Glenda Raymond.